Welcome to Leaders of Tomorrow on ET Now, the only daily show for MSMEs where you get center stage. We bring you expert voices and the biggest names to address all of your questions and queries. Today, I'm in conversation with Nitin Rakesh, CEO and Director of Mphasis. Thank you very much for speaking with us here on Leaders of Tomorrow. Let me start by talking to you about, you know, you've taken over at Mphasis a few months ago, what that transition period, what that journey has been like, and what the past couple of months have been like.
Sure, thank you. I think it's been about 6 months now, and just delivered the first full quarter. So I think the first 2 or 3 months was more about transition, making sure that I understand the culture of the company, go and see as many clients and employees as possible. And I think it's been a good, I would say a very stable transition. And now that we moved into the next phase, which is kind of what we call stability and acceleration. So we've focused on really figuring out what's the best way for us to move forward. Can we find the growth back? The company's been very receptive to that idea. We've, in a way, reset the next 3-4 year strategic plan as well. I work closely with the board to talk about what we should be doing as a company for the next 3 to 5 years. And right now we're deeply busy engaged in executing that plan.
You've come in from Syntel, I noticed, and I want to really talk about how the Indian IT industry is looking when we compare it with our global peers. The 2016 and the end of 2015 wasn't a very good phase for the domestic IT industry. How are things now looking when we compare ourselves on a global stage?
Yeah, I think firstly, the myth of Indian IT is IT is the only thing that is truly global, right? So I think the fortunes of the sector that we call Indian IT is typically what I call the software services industry. I think it's fairly globally linked as well. Our fortunes are tied to our clients' businesses and how they need servicing. It's fair to say that over the last 2, maybe 3 years, the competitive intensity from quote-unquote digital upstarts, what I call the Amazonization of the world, has actually gathered pace. That obviously means that the type of activities and services that we were focused on with our customers and clients has to pivot, because we need to then help them stay relevant to their end consumers. Mm-hmm. So the focus has kind of slowly shifted from focusing on core back office IT systems or enterprise applications or package implementations to more nimble consumer-facing tech. Adoption of client-facing, front-end apps, applying cognitive to, expand that experience that the end consumer sees with an enterprise. So if you're a bank or an insurance company or a retailer, I think a lot of the focus really is in revolutionizing your experience for the end consumers. Mm. And that's why I think the big pivot really is away from core systems, more in favor of consumer-facing tech.
Okay.
And that's kind of been the big story over the last 2 to 3 years.
And has there been a lot of shift away from doing basic ADM work as far as at least your mid-size IT companies? Do you see enough innovation happening?
Yeah, I think the ADM is still very much part and parcel of what we do. But the way you deliver those services is pivoting and changing, because like anything else, there's a shelf life for a service type or a service offering or a business model. And the reason I say that is that what used to be 3, 4, 5 year development project is now crunched into a 3 month release cycle. You need to launch the minimum viable product in 3 months and then keep enhancing it, just like you download an app and it updates itself every day almost. And I think that concept is now being embraced by enterprises, which is why the way we deliver ADM services is actually shifting. But the core nature of services isn't really that different. The amount of innovation can always be more. I think we have to find a way to bridge core IT to digital. We have to find a way to do things much more efficiently using automation. Obviously, IT industry by definition is an automation business. You're automating a workflow or a business process. Hence, you build a software and technology helps you there. So I think the amount of innovation has been good, but we can always do more. We can always find smarter ways of embracing new technologies. The good news, though, is a lot of revolution is already happening in the open source world. I think for us, for companies in our industry, whether they're mid-size or large, the biggest opportunity is how do you embrace this explosion in new tech and how do you apply it to help your clients embrace that.
Mm. I want to talk about the domestic market and the domestic market in terms of revenues for companies. The government has been going all out to promote and push programs like Make in India, Startup India, Skill India, etc. Is that resulting in more revenues from the domestic market for companies?
Yeah, I think we don't play that much in the domestic market anymore, but if you look at growth by segment, I think you can see domestic market actually growing pretty healthy double digits for almost every company that operates in the segment. So clearly the digital India push, the city, smart cities of the future, you know, demonetization and the whole payments and wallets. And I think I can tell you that Indian enterprises are fairly smart and nimble in how they're embracing tech, whether you're a bank or an insurance company or you're a retailer. So I think that seems to be a lot of buzz in the domestic Indian market. And I think it probably will continue, you know, for a period of time as well.
India is about 36 million MSMEs, a large percentage of whom are not necessarily based in tier 1 or tier 2 towns. Do you see enough adoption and understanding of technology amongst smaller companies?
I think, again, in my limited interaction that I've had at various NASSCOM forums, there is a realization that there's never been a better time to embrace tech and essentially use that from an exponential perspective. Also, a lot of new developments are happening in open source, which means you don't have to actually pay for a lot of the licensed software. Cloud becomes another rapid deployment, low capex, early adoption for MSMEs. And I think if you talk to large providers of platform as a service or cloud, they're seeing explosive growth coming out of MSMEs, whether it's Google Cloud, whether it's AWS, whether it's Microsoft Azure. So I think that seems to be, this is probably one of the best phases for young companies to embrace futuristic tech because they don't have the curse of having invested in legacy systems.
Okay, so you're talking about cloud. We have a call-in show on Leaders of Tomorrow where a lot of the questions that come in around the use of technology is small businesses telling us we don't have the funds which is required to be able to go aggressive as far as technology adoption is concerned.
Sure.
Where is then the lack of information about using cloud, about using SaaS, for example? Where is that gap happening and how can the adoption then be encouraged?
Yeah, I think the fundamental premise that is changing is in the traditional way of applying tech, you would spend a lot of money up front, either in buying, setting up a data center, buying the hardware, buying the servers, buying licensed software, and then customizing it to your needs. Today, I think what you can do is you can convert all of that upfront capital into an ongoing pay-as-you-go, pay-by-the-drink model. Obviously, the fundamental premise is you are essentially don't have the ability to custom build everything. So if you are very, very focused on having a very specific, unique software, then it's not going to work. But in most cases, whether it's payroll, whether it's internal applications like finance and accounting, Salesforce CRM type discussions, you can actually get up and running pretty quick. Now Salesforce is a golden standard, but there are others that are much more financially viable for MSMEs. Salesforce is probably more enterprise driven. But I'm just using that as an example. So I think the ability to apply ready-made, pay-as-you-go, plug-and-play software is never been higher than it is today.
We were talking about Digital India. I want to talk about Skill India.
Sure.
I remember a survey that NASSCOM had put out a few years ago. Correct me if I'm wrong, but only 25% of all students coming out of colleges, NASSCOM had said, were employable. I don't know if the numbers have improved, but without necessarily focusing too much on the numbers,
sure.
What is the situation like on the ground? Are companies like yourself still having to train extensively students coming out of colleges? What's going to fix that?
I think there is a growing realization. So there is a skills council that NASSCOM also put together to kind of address some of these concerns. At a very basic level, one of the core skills required for the next few years, especially for our sector, is what we call software engineering. Right? And I think that's a pivot that we need colleges to make with us. That's a pivot that we are expanding competency level-wise through NASSCOM as well. And the reason I say that is that, the software development lifecycle used to be waterfall, sequential, one step after the next. Each step you could specialize somebody to do it. Now it's all collapsing into a single stack. So you need core engineering skills much higher than what you needed before, because earlier you could have the architects and the coders do the engineering work and everything else could be supplemented. So I think that is a fundamental pivot that we are trying to make. And I think each company has a different strategy. We are obviously doing it, you know, we were partnering with colleges both on both sides of the continent. In the US we're doing it, in India we're doing it. But I think it's a journey that that actually requires a lot more work to be done.
Nathan, do stay tuned. We'll take a very quick break, but much more on what's happening in the IT industry and what you, the MSME entrepreneur, should keep in mind on the other side. Do stay tuned. Welcome back with us here on Leaders of Tomorrow, and tonight we're in conversation with Emphasis to talk about the IT industry and what IT giants are doing when it comes to encouraging entrepreneurship. So whether it's skilling, whether it's upskilling or reskilling, everything comes at a cost. A company like Emphasis is able to factor in that cost. But your advice for small companies that are struggling with this problem about how they can overcome the cost and at the same time find the kind of talent they're looking for?
Yeah, I think the good news is that it's actually that much easier to learn new skills because of explosion in you don't need to set up a training facility, you don't need to put people through a classroom. As long as you find people who have the core skill of learnability, they can actually pick up new skills. Obviously, that's the good news. The not so good news is that it does require an effort to find the right kind of people and to create the right infrastructure for them to be able to access it, even if it is an online MOOC library that you want to create for learning. So I think, again, it's a different way of thinking, but the answer to almost every challenge today happens to be, how can I deploy technology more efficiently? How can I actually create a gamify learning, right? How can I create a very simple rewards point system? So any, you know, like we are doing it at, you know, at Emphasis, which is create a game, let them learn a new competency, let them learn some new points, and you use the points in any which way you want, but effectively you're creating a fairly nimble, flexible way for people to learn new competencies.
And at the intersection of technology and hiring, of course, yeah, are the headlines of late that said that even as companies are using more and more technology, your dependence on having huge numbers of people is coming down. Is it going to ensure that the jobs are now going to become more high-end? Are you going to hire fewer people? What's the outlook?
Yeah, I think we still need, end of the day, we are selling services. We still need a pretty healthy number of people to support the service model. This is nothing new. Every few years, trends change and needs change. Technology, by definition, has a shelf life, so you move to the next wave and the next wave, from mainframe to client server to digital to cloud. So I think this journey will continue. What has changed is that the time scales are shrinking because the shelf life is actually getting smaller, and there is an explosion on the different types of technologies, but they all obviously have fundamental bases. So if you identify those fundamental bases, I think you're going to be able to find that you actually can redeploy these people as well. And now, whether we're going to need as many people as we needed in the past is a function of two things. One, the growth rates. I think it's a matter of time before we start to see the balance come back between core IT and what we call digital, which is basically where the growth is. But the other parameter is, how do you deploy productivity and automation? I think my advice to all budding engineers, existing employees, is make automation your friend. Actually use how best to apply it, because those will be skills that you will definitely be always be in demand, at least for the next few years.
Okay, let's talk about entrepreneurship and what companies like yourself are doing to encourage more of your employees to think like entrepreneurs. Before I get into the details of the program that you do have, I want to talk about why it's perhaps important for companies to encourage your employees to think like entrepreneurs.
Yeah, I think clear two reasons and two ways to promote it. Firstly, this mindset of, we think of ourselves as a billion-dollar startup. And the reason I say that is, there are so many parts of the business that are at early stages today. Even though the company may in itself is more than 25 years old, but there are many things we do today that have only been launched in the last 12, 18 months. And a good example is the whole voice-assisted interface, right? What used to be voice dialing is now actually pretty much taking over every aspect of interface, you know, whether it is Alexa or Siri or Cortana, right? So can we, you know, promote our people to start thinking about the potential opportunities that exist with what's coming out of the tech world? How do you apply it to existing clients? And more importantly, can we actually launch new services and products based on it?
Okay.
And that's kind of the mindset. So the mindset always is, we have a labs program, we have a Carta program that, you know, we talked about. The labs program is all about applying futuristic tech to existing businesses. The Carta program is, okay, take an idea and actually launch a business around it. And we have a group within, you know, from our leadership team that actually evaluates ideas. We ask people to send ideas. There's a formal program around it as well. But more, at the end of the day, what we're really trying to do is encourage innovation and encourage a way where we can actually apply and bring constant value. We also have a co-innovation program with our customers where we actually jointly identify areas to work on and again promote innovative ideas from our employees.
For large IT companies that are perhaps as a de-risking strategy looking at the domestic market, your advice for smaller IT players who are only looking at the domestic sure. market about how they ensure that they're able to stand out, how you're able to compete, because the level, you know, the playing field is being leveled. So how are you competing with a larger player?
I think my only advice to not so large players, whether you're small or medium sized, is a relative question. I mean, we live with this every day too, right? Because we are competing with companies that are anywhere from 10 to 35 times our size, 40 times our size. My only advice is find an area that you can focus on and build a very deep specialization in that area, and that's the only way you can actually stand out. Mm-hmm. So differentiation only comes from focus, especially when you are competing with large players. Obviously, everyone will take a different strategic approach. I think we took an approach of staying focused and specialist and continuing to deepen that specialization. And now we're complementing that with cloud and cognitive, for example, to support the depth of expertise we have in wealth management, for example.
What do you think about the innovation that's happening as far as digital startups and digital companies are concerned? Do you see any sort of trends that are going to particularly pick up in the domestic market that a lot of then smaller companies can sort of look at to tap into?
Yeah, I think there are two ways to look at it. Firstly, the consumer-facing industries obviously are getting much more focused from digital startups. Good example is obviously retail. Supply chain automation, the whole entertainment media business, again, a lot of digital work going on there. My belief is there will probably be a number of services that will emerge that will actually help you lower your cost of operations and, more importantly, your quality of service. For example, everything is as a service today. Right. So if you can embrace as a service model in the way you construct your business, that potentially is a game changer. And transportation is available as a service. You don't really need to own the entire value chain of transportation either. So for example, when we talked about how you can embrace cloud and some of these technologies too. So I think it's an interesting time. The only thing that hinders what you can do is your own imagination in terms of how do you apply tech.
Okay. Going back to what you were saying about nearshore geographies, what are some of the countries or geographies that you think are going to pick up in prominence and compete perhaps with India going forward?
I think you already saw over the last 4 or 5 years Eastern Europe becoming a pretty interesting.
Philippines also.
Philippines has been there,
work,
especially for non-IT work. Mm. We've seen Poland emerge. And I think can you complement the capabilities that those geographies bring with the scale we have? And can you actually then embrace and become a truly global delivery business? And that's kind of a way to approach it.
Mm. Speaking of strategy, would you advise for companies to perhaps move away from the core strategy that they have if they realize it's not working? Would you recommend and advise that they perhaps look at different geographies, different verticals, or stay true to your core? Especially if you're a smaller company, don't spread yourself too thin, or try and get a leg in as many industries or geographies as you can, so that would be a de-risking strategy.
See, personally, I'm a big believer in focus. Obviously, you need to choose where to focus correctly. And strategy at the end is nothing but a set of choices you make. And you have to make those choices with enough information and enough research and enough data. Mm-hmm. I'm personally not a big believer in spreading too thin, because companies that especially mid-size or smaller who compete with larger players, you will find very hard to invest appropriately. You rather pick your battles and then really try to, and the analogy I give is you pick your anthills and be the king of those anthills.
A startup co-working space that has featured previously on Leaders of Tomorrow was telling us that the number of startups that they have seen last year was about 4,000, and this year it has come down to about 140 as we speak. Mm-hmm. Has there been a slowdown in the kind of startups and the kind of innovation that we're seeing in India, or do you think because valuations for startups, so valuations for digital businesses are getting more rationalized, do you think that this was bound to happen?
I think it's a I'm a big believer in self-correcting phenomena, so there was probably the pendulum swung too far. I think we're probably going to find neither was 4,000 the right number, nor is 150 the right number. We'll probably find the right balance on a long-term basis, but I don't think innovation has slowed down. I think it's happening. It's happening in every aspect. It's happening inside of companies. It's happening with startups. I don't think startups is the only way to innovate. I think innovation can happen anywhere. So, but I do think that the market forces play an important role. Availability of funding plays an important role. Expectations of investors plays an important role. And potentially, I think every entrepreneur sooner or later realizes that end of the day, you have to create economic value by doing the basics right, and the basics happen to be revenue and profits.
All right. What are the next few years looking like for you then at Mphasis?
I think we are started well on the journey over the last few months, as I said. I think with the new regime of new shareholder and obviously well begun is half done, but it's only half done, a lot more work to do. We are very, very focused on essentially being a next generation services company to our enterprise clients worldwide. And that involves significant capabilities to be built from ground up. That involves new partners to be found. That involves new ways of delivering our services. And I think it's an exciting time.
Nitin, thank you very much for speaking with us here on Leaders of Tomorrow. That wraps up this conversation with Mphasis. If you have anything that you want to tell us or you want to be featured here on the show, do remember you can always write in at leadersoftomorrowtimesgroup.com. On social media, tweet at me personally at Sunanda_J or LOT_ET now. On Facebook, we're on Leaders of Tomorrow on ET now. Call us on that number you see on your screen. We love hearing from you. We promise to have all your questions answered. Thanks for watching. Have a good night.